So for those of you who weren't here yesterday, which were also quite a lot, lightning talks are basically 5-minute talks that basically every Congress attendant can give if he manages to register soon enough. And sometimes also 3 minutes. We'll have 2 short talks of 3 minutes in this session. And to make sure that all the talkers keep their time, we have this so-called timekeeper, a nifty device developed by Alex. Alex, would you like to introduce your timekeeper?
Of course, I would like to introduce it again. But everybody was here and has seen how it works. It's quite simple. If your talking time starts, then just a minute. It should go green, yes. No?
It's still in demo mode.
We have intermittent failures for some reason. We try to fix it. I explain it now. And if your talk starts, okay, we have no network.
Or maybe I explain it and you fix it. So normally this shows a green column that goes up to the top within 4 minutes. So you're still in a safe range if this goes all the way green. And then for the last minute, it turns, there it comes. So that's what you see in the first 4 minutes. It slowly fills up. And at this point, you're close to 4 minutes.
You don't need to hurry. You were talking so fast last day. And if everything is green, you have still more than 1 minute. Only in the last minute you have, things start to turn a bit yellow. And for the last 30 seconds, you see the yellow signal going up to the top. And now you still have 30 seconds. And only when the red bar is on the top, then your time will for sure be up. And I think the funny thing on the lightning talks is that things are fast. Speakers have to keep to their time. And so except they ask for another 1 or 2 minutes, and you give them the 1 or 2 minutes, they will now have 5 seconds. And if they have 5 seconds left, I make this sign. And you know what you do when I make this sign 5 seconds? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. We have to try this again, I think.
Okay, just one more time, because we don't have so much time.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Marvelous.
Okay, very nice. So that's how we keep the time. If you don't know when your time slot is as a speaker, then you can recheck this on the Wiki Mirror, because I think the Wiki is down right now. Just look at the start page. There should be the lightning talk, a link to the lightning talk schedules. The schedule for day 4 is obsolete. We don't have a current schedule somewhere in the web. Right now, I will try to upload a schedule for tomorrow somewhere. So day 4, don't look at this page for day 4. As a speaker now, you should sit in front if you know that your talk comes up soon. Then, as soon as the previous talker has finished, you should quickly get up and get to the stage. Exchange the clicker so you can advance the slides. And remember to talk into the microphone. You can see your slides down here on the monitor. You don't have to turn around to look at the slides up there, because then people can't hear you and you won't get your message across.
The clicker should work now. We optimized the radio setup here.
It was probably the range.
To the left. And if you have big photographs on your pages, they might load a bit slowly, so be patient. No,
I think I checked it this time. So all the slides should advance quickly. There's a translation available for every talk. So English talks get translated to German. German talks get translated to English. Just dial the deck number 8014 for this room. Now let's have a great session and start with the first talk.
Hallo, wir haben... Funktioniert? Ja. Okay, wir möchten uns euch unser Projekt vorstellen, Netentum XM. Wir haben sind 2 wissenschaftliche Mitarbeiter, Stefan und Johann, also ich bin Johannes, und wir haben uns dieses Jahr für unsere Grundlagenvorlesung Rechnernetze haben wir uns ein bisschen was extra überlegt. Grundlagenrechnernetze seit 2015, jetzt auch mit IPv6, sind ungefähr 700 Studenten. Das heißt, das, was wir euch erzählen, haben wir wirklich ausprobiert und sind nicht irgendwelche Fantasiegespenste. Insgesamt haben wir 1125 Klausurvorlagen gehabt, plus natürlich nochmal ungefähr die Hälfte für Studenten, die nicht gekommen sind, und nochmal einen halben Wagen Testdrucke. Haben das Ganze mit ein paar QR-Codes versehen, haben eine Korrektur durchgeführt, haben die ganzen Sachen dann gescannt und am Ende die Ergebnisse automatisch rausgehauen. Wie funktioniert jetzt die Klausur? Wir haben Klausurvorlagen. Entsprechend, wer irgendwie sich das Ganze mal anschauen will, weil er auch wissenschaftlicher Mitarbeiter ist, kommt her. Jede einzelne Klausur ist individuell. Eventuell kann sie auch individuelle Inhalte enthalten. Und jede einzelne Seite ist durchnummeriert, das heißt, wenn wir das Ganze einscannen und selbst wenn die Seiten durcheinander kommen, können wir jede Seite noch entsprechend zuordnen. Man braucht natürlich einen einigermaßen sinnvollen Drucker, damit man da 700 Klausuren in Einzelvariante ausdrucken kann. Das Ganze natürlich irgendwie LaTeX, MöbTeX, TeX und ein bisschen Make und viel schlaflose Nächte. Und die Frage ist, wenn wir jetzt die Klausuren haben, ein Problem ist, dass wir teilweise die Namen oder Matrikelnummern nicht lesen können und es natürlich sehr schade ist, wenn ein Student eine Klausur mitgeschrieben hat, es ist alles stressvoll und man die Ergebnisse nicht zuordnen kann. Deshalb haben wir jetzt die Namen auf den Klausuren auch wegrationalisiert und ersetzen das Ganze durch Sticker mit QR-Codes, damit wir es zuordnen können. Und das ist dann das, was auch wirklich im Hörsaal passiert und erst dann ist die Klausur einem Student zugeordnet. Und es braucht einzig und allein noch eine Unterschrift, die aber auch wegrationalisiert werden kann.
Jo, also die nach der Klausur beim Einsammeln, ne, nach dem Einsammeln korrigieren wir die erstmal ganz normal durch. Sieht dann etwa so aus, ne, also der Student schreibt halt in die Lösungsboxen rein und das Besondere ist jetzt, dass wir bei der Korrektur halt unsere Korrekturanmerkungen quasi in diese kleinen Boxen hier, ne, reinmachen. Also wir kreuzen quasi die erzielten Punktzahlen an. Linke Spalte ist Erstkorrektur, rechte Spalte ist bei uns Zweitkorrektur und wenn man sich verkreuzt, das kann schon mal passieren, ja, dann muss man halt so ein Fältchen hier ausfüllen, dann kann man es neu ankreuzen. Wenn man sich da nochmal verkreuzt, also sprich wieder zurück will auf das durchgestrichene, nach, dann haben wir Korrektursticker, die man dann drüber kleben kann. Ist also auch alles irgendwie gelöst. In dem Barcode, wer sich das fragt, da sind nur Teilaufgabe, Aufgabe und maximal erzielbare Punktzahl reinkodiert, damit wir das nachher bei der Bilderkennung alles schön zuordnen können. Jedenfalls nach der Korrektur schneiden wir die Klausuren hier hinten an dem Falz einfach mit einem Stapelschneider auf, ne? Lassen die durch einen großen Scanner durch und machen dann entsprechend eine Bilderkennung drauf, eine Auswertung, insbesondere halt von diesen kleinen Punkteboxen. Ne? Wir können uns selber nicht mehr verzählen dabei. Das ist auch irgendwie stressvoll, zumindest ich kriege immer Kopfschmerzen davon, wenn ich Punkte zusammenzählen muss bei der Korrektur. Ne? Danach haben wir eine Einzelerfassung der einzelnen Ergebnisse. Wir können das Ganze als PDF binden, wir können die Einsicht präsenzlos gestalten, wir können es den Studenten online stellen und möglicherweise können wir es auch irgendwann mal digital archivieren, sofern die Rechtsabteilung dazu stimmt. Hier sehen wir jetzt dann so eine Auswertung nochmal. Diese eine Seite hier ist dann generiert, ne? Das ist, kommt dann aus Tech nochmal raus. Da sehen wir dann hier die Einzelergebnisse, zum Beispiel hier eine Wiederholungsprüfung, was der Student in der Midterm hatte, in irgendwelchen Assignments hatte, die Gesamtpunktzahl, die erzielte Note, das Notenintervall, in dem er liegt, damit er weiß, wie viele Punkte er vielleicht bräuchte bis zur nächsten besseren Note. Und wenn es halt irgendwelche Fehler gab bei der Bilderkennung schon oder dann bei der Einsicht, ne? Dann machen wir hier unten, das passiert dann ebenfalls digital, entsprechende kleine Anmerkungen mit rein, damit der Student dann eben sieht, was passiert ist, ob es Änderungen gab oder wie auch immer. Ne? Ja, für die Zukunft planen wir noch eine grafische Oberfläche dazu. Momentan ist das alles irgendwie eine Skriptsammlung, sprich nur von Nerds zu bedienen. Wir wollen eine Smartphone-App noch programmieren, sodass wir auch die Anwesenheitskontrolle an sich eigentlich digitalisieren können, damit wir wissen, wie viele Klausuren wir momentan haben beim Einsammeln, damit wir gleich nicht mehr zählen müssen am Ende. Und ja, wer Lust hat und sich das Ganze mal anschauen will, ihr findet uns unten in der Halle hinten da bei diesem kleinen Holzhäuschen. Ne?
Thanks a lot. Next talk, Easy RPG.
So. Okay. Hello everybody, I'm Gabriel and I will talk today about a project where I'm involved in since 5 years called Easy RPG. This is a open source re-implementation of the RPG Maker 2000 and 2003 engine. If you've never heard about this engine, it's basically providing a toolset which provides an editor to with a user-friendly interface to create your own RPG games, which are in the style of Final Fantasy games from the NES and Super Nintendo era. Yeah, and of course an engine to play it. Yeah, and there are many games created with this engine. Some popular ones, especially in Germany, are for example Vampire Story and Unterwegs in Düsterburg. If you're a bit older, you probably have already heard about them because they were shipped many years ago on Bravo Screen Fun CDs. And more international games are for example IB, Watanuhara and Humaniki. Yeah, first a bit about the history. So the original engine was of course released in 2000 by a company called Esky Corporation in Japan only. And then it was illegally translated to English by a Russian guy called Don Miguel. I have no idea how this guy looks like, but he shipped a sample game with his illegal translation and he chose this avatar of himself. So you play himself in this game. Yeah, and so this fact means basically all games that were created with this engine outside of Japan are illegal, so, well, but there was something really unexpected for us. In mid-2015, there was an official English release, so this was really a shock for us, so it basically means, oh, was our project for it completely useless, but no, the official company lost their source code, so they also can't extend their own engine. Very lucky for us. So what is our motivation? Of course, it's completely Windows only, so we want to try to different operating systems, so it's also cool to play it on mobile devices. Yeah, then the original engine was reverse engineered by some people and they added assembler hacks and patches to extend the functionality a bit. This is really a pain for us because we can't really emulate this, but there are only a small amount of patches, so we can at least simulate a few of them. Yeah, another issue is that this program is from Windows 98 times, so it's not supporting Unicode. So it basically means when you create a game here in Germany, a guy in Japan can probably not play it because it's a different code page, and you can also can't play Japanese games in Europe. So here is a screenshot of one game. On the right side, you can see the correct Japanese name, but when you want to play this game on your German Windows, you have to use the file name on the left, so some random emoji bake. And of course, we solved this problem by auto-detecting the encoding. And of course, we also plan to extend the engine later, maybe with additional functionality instead of sticking to unofficial hacks and patches. Oh, and there's also one interesting thing. When you look at Japanese games, they always create great games only by using the functionality of the original engine. These patches are only used in Europe and US. So different culture. So what do we need? Of course, we need some users to play with our engine. We don't really collect any statistics, so we don't know how many use it, but we also have it in Google Play Store, and Google is so friendly to provide all the data to us. And so we know that most of the users are from Japan, 50% of the users are from Japanese, and it would be nice to have some shift to other countries. And of course, we also need developers for the player and for the editor. So our editor is basically currently on hold because we have no developers for it. And there's also now this official release, which you can usually get in the Steam Summer Sale for €5, so there's not much motivation anymore for the editor currently. And we also need artists to replace the so-called runtime package. This is they provide default assets that are shipped with all games, and we want to replace them with three relative common ones. Yeah, and of course, we are cross-platform. We run on basically all systems besides the standard ones, also Android, Wii. The 3DS port is currently work in progress, but will come someday. Yeah, and you can, of course, also play it with our ASM.js compiled version now directly in your browser. So if you have a laptop with you, just visit easy-rpg.org/play. Yeah, and then you can play directly our test game in your browser. It runs best with Chrome and if you use Windows 10 with Edge browser. Firefox has a slight audio delay, so it's not as nice. Yeah, so I will keep it open for a few more seconds, so you can type in the URL. Okay, yeah, so if you have any questions, just talk to me or write us an email or easyrpg@freenode. Thank you.
Thanks. Okay, we'll continue right away with the next talk.
Hallo. Muss ich selber klicken?
Na.
Sehr schön. Hallo. Aus urheberrechtlichen Gründen sind nur Teile der Sendung im Podcast enthalten. Das gilt natürlich nicht für diesen Vortrag hier, sondern das bezieht sich darauf, wenn man bei öffentlich-rechtlichen Radiosendern Podcasts hören mag, wird man diesen Text wahrscheinlich früher oder später schon mal gesehen haben. Darüber habe ich mich geärgert. Ich hätte es gerne anders. Ich hätte gerne die Sendungen, wie sie im Bayerischen Rundfunk zum Beispiel laufen oder im Deutschlandfunk, ist es etwas einfacher. Oder auch auf einem Münchner Studentensender. Ich hätte gerne die Sendungen 1:1, die ich mir aussuche als Podcast, würde die gerne als RSS-Feed abonnieren. Und außerdem hätte ich gerne die Metadaten dieser Sendungen als Open Data, um zum Beispiel in ein paar Jahren mal nachzurecherchieren, wie oft denn der Berater, der die Bahn beraten hat, in den Morgensendungen zum Thema Bahnstreik, Lokführerstreik interviewt wurde, und dann zu sehen, dass der über mehrere Jahre immer wieder aktiv ist. So, jetzt gibt's, die Radiosender haben riesige Budgets, sind riesige Organisationen mit Milliardenbudgets, die können mit riesigen Rechtsabteilungen, mit riesigen IT-Abteilungen nicht so besonders schnell reagieren. Die können ein paar Dinge sehr gut, das sind Inhalte produzieren, das tun sie auch sehr gut. Außerdem können sie sehr gut bis in jedes Mauseloch in die Provinz senden. Aber was sie nicht können, ist das bereits gesendete, zuverlässig in Podcasts packen, die Sendungsdaten eben wie gesagt als Open Data rausgeben und die Podcasts auch beibehalten, ohne dass es dann Lochfraß gibt und spontan Sendungen verschwinden oder die recht schnell aus dem Podcast entfernt werden. Was aber jeder kann, ist sich einen Raspi kaufen für ein paar Euro, den Radiorekorder von mir drauf installieren. Dann muss man sich noch ein Domainname aussuchen, weil RSS-Feeds wollen wissen, wo sie liegen, damit man sie abrufen kann. Und einen Benutzernamen und ein Passwort für die MP3s, wenn man es dann ins Netz stellt, weil Privatkopie darf nur begrenzt verteilt werden und nicht beliebig häufig. Ja, und dann kann man, sowas ist natürlich im Fernsehen, da kann ich leider nichts machen, aber dann kann man Radiosendungen selbst aufgenommen als Podcast dauerhaft hören, mit Musik, so wie es komplett gesendet wurde. Und die Sendungsinfos bleiben dauerhaft verfügbar und werden nicht mehr nach ein paar Wochen entfernt, wenn der Radiosender lustig ist oder wenn die ihr CMS umstellen oder wenn irgendetwas passiert, sondern die sind da und die bleiben da. Ein paar Zahlen zum Abschluss. Das Ganze läuft bei mir in einem Rechenzentrum-Server. Es wurde entwickelt auf einem Raspi, läuft auch auf einem Raspi. Es sind inzwischen 700.000 Sendungen, deren Metadaten da rumliegen. Es sind ca. 7.000 Aufnahmen, die im Laufe der Zeit gemacht wurden und dann natürlich wieder weggeworfen wurden, aber eben so, wie ich das will und nicht wie der Radiosender das will. Und das sind momentan nur 11 Sender, das sind die, die ich selber höre. Man muss dafür einen Scraper schreiben, weil man die Programminfos aus dem HTML destillieren muss. Die Sender bieten da eben, wie gesagt, keine Open-Data-Formate an. Und das Ding läuft seit einigen Jahren wunderbar. Mich würde jetzt interessieren, den im Laufe der Zeit noch ein bisschen abzuspecken, zu vereinfachen. Das ist ein wilder Technikmix, weil ich das so nach und nach zusammengestöpselt habe. Und Erfahrungen, die andere damit machen. Vielleicht ist das für Journalisten interessant, die Medien beobachten wollen, was wurde wann, wie, wo gesendet, eigenes Archiv. Man ist da nicht auf das Wohlwollen von irgendjemandem anderen angewiesen, sondern kann selbst ein Archiv führen. Ja, bedanke ich mich für die Aufmerksamkeit und wünsche noch weiterhin einen schönen Kongress.
Vielen Dank. Next talk is going to be in English again, Panopticon.
Hi, good morning. Wanted to introduce you to Panopticon, a game of data and control. A couple of years ago, I was organizing Brighton Crypto Festival, and we were trying to think about ways in which we could involve kids more in stuff. You know, it was kind of a crypto party with talks and other things, but we wanted to introduce kids, so we came up with the idea of making a board game based on, kind of loosely based on the idea of Panopticon. Everybody here know what a Panopticon is? No, okay. So the original idea of the Panopticon was actually a prison. And the idea is that there's this central point in the prison, this tower, a control tower, from where everybody, the guards in the control tower can see everybody in the prison, everybody around in the cells. And the point is that it could be that the guard was watching you or they weren't watching you. You didn't know. In this illustration, it's one of the original illustrations, you can see the guard. But the idea is that maybe you're being watched or maybe you're not. But the point, the central idea is this tower, which can control the zone that it's involved in. So talking to a colleague, Mafje Alvarez, who has worked on some games things, we came up with the idea of a board game, and as we were making it up as we went along, we decided, right, what can we do? What do we have at home? Everybody has Lego, so we decided to build this game based around Lego. We created, as you can see, we got a Scrabble board we put turned upside down there. We created some basic characters, again, in this hexagonal form, in the form of the Panopticon. And the basic thing, the basic idea is that the blue crystals you can see is the person's is a person's life on the internet or on the web. Each player gets a card which is defining defining the part they have to play in the game. And the idea is to accumulate as much data as possible. As you accumulate data, your tower rises and you become more powerful by claiming, and your reach extends. You can see further, you can get pieces from further. Each of the different colored Lego blocks are pieces of data. And if you can get the crystal, then obviously you win the game. At the end of the game, the person with the highest tower has the most power. So we decided that we would, it's an open source game, it's under a Creative Commons license, and we put it on GitHub, so you can fork it, you could take the game, you could do what you want with it. We just developed it at this time for this specific purpose, but you could take, for example, the character cards, you can make your own character cards, you can, you know, redesign them into whatever you want to use it for. All of the development we've done, actually, of the game has been by playing it at different events and things. This was, again, in Brighton, a theatre company that wanted to work on some ideas about data and control and things, so we actually took it to this theatre company, played it with those people, developed it there. This was the first prototype, as you could see. We just accumulate any bits of Lego we could steal from our kids and gave different characteristics to them, power-ups, etc., etc. Again, another viewpoint of a more developed viewpoint of the game. I guess you all know that saying. We decided early on that within the game, we weren't going to make it so that you could only win by being good. If you want to be an asshole, you could win the game. You could be a bad person and accumulate and get as much data as possible from the others. You didn't have to be good or bad because, as we know, technology is neither good nor bad, nor is it neutral. The information for the game is, as I say, it's on the GitHub page. Like the last guy, I shall leave this up for a long time so you can get that down. You can contact me if you want, but you can just take the game, run with it, develop your own versions of it, use it for whatever you want, translate it. If you do anything, please, you know, ping me and tell me what you're doing with it, what's going on, how you're using it. I'll be thrilled to know that, and I'll put it up on the site as well. So, thank you.
Thank you. Now, I think the next talk is going to be 16 to 9. Geocoding. I think he also has 3 minutes. So let's go.
Hi, I'm Thomas. I'm doing stuff with OpenStreetMap. And geocoding is a very complex topic in geoinformatic and geo stuff in general. And that's basically the process of transforming an address into, or a description of a place into a coordinate. So you type in like your street and your city and you get like a coordinate on a map. And it sounds pretty easy, but it is not. Yeah, because the general approach that nerds take is like, look at the technical aspects of this stuff. So they think, oh, let's do some Elasticsearch and some string matching and some, yeah, look a bit on the string and then we're going to be fine and we're going to find the right place. And yeah, normally it doesn't work properly because like this is not a technical problem, this is a cultural problem because the pointer, is, yeah. Because you have things like ranking, so you can mean something different than you than the computer is thinking. So you type in Berlin, and the computer thinks, oh, there's a restaurant called Berlin, but you mean the city. And there's a whole set of cultural problems, because we note addresses in a different kind than people in Japan, for example. There are no streets, there are like blocks, and there are like different house numbers and so on. And we need to understand like this cultural problem of noting addresses and of this whole structure worldwide. And I want to kick off some intercultural collaboration for that. So I want to have some approach for that where we take together all the data from worldwide, how we note addresses, and put it together in like one collection of information, of knowledge about that topic. I started with a small Git repository. I have some technical problems with the pointer. Where I want to define queries, conventions, and limitations of addresses with people around the world. So people from other regions from the world can collaborate and add the data and describe how addresses are noted, how places are described in the place. And yeah, I started with the German specification, some more or less, where I wrote down how addresses are normally noted, how postal codes look like, how streets look like, and how people normally note addresses. And I want you to collaborate, and I ask you to add your data, if you're especially from another country than Germany. Tell the world how addresses are used in your country, and yeah. Look how we can have a better geocoding in the future. Thanks.
Thanks. So I'm sorry, video people, it was actually 4-3, so false alarm.
Okay. Hi, I'm Janusz, and I'm doing some research for my master thesis at Technische Universität München. And it's a cooperation with Hochschule Rotterdam and the Wetenschaftlich Untersuch- und Dokumentationszentrum, so it's the Scientific Research and Documentation Center of the Dutch Ministry of Justice. And they have this idea of a cybersecurity dashboard. They are monitoring some cybersecurity state of the Netherlands, and they want to have their governmental infrastructure and also the critical infrastructure of the country to be secure. So there shouldn't be any threats, and if there are some threats, they want to know it about it, defend against them, and they have this idea of this dashboard that could probably help certs to give some them some knowledge about it. But the problem is what should be visualized in that dashboard and in which way and for which people. And what I was thinking, how do those people, especially inside the government, think about cybersecurity? What does that mean to them, and how are the differences? And I did interviews with 7 people from Dutch governmental institutions, and I grouped those people into operations, analytical, and management people. And my assumption beforehand was that if you want to try to build a dashboard for so many people, there will be problems, because I think especially management people have a different understanding than the others. So one question that I gave them in the interviews was, there's Alice who works for a bank, and she regularly accesses data on an application system, and the system is in the internet. Mallory does not like the bank, and how can he steal data from the system? And then I asked the experts to explain to me how this attack from Mallory could work. And this is now an analyst who described to me, Mallory sent an email to Alice. This email looks identical to the one from the bank, and it says, your account has been hacked. We have taken measures to secure it. but you need to log in and make sure everything is secure. When she clicks on a link, she doesn't go to the bank, she actually goes to his malicious system, which looks identical to the bank. As she fills in her password and username, the password and username is sent back to Alice. So this explanation goes a bit further, it was a bit more detailed, but overall he described, so this analyst described a phishing attack very detailed and also made a nice drawing for that. So there is the phishing email to Alice, and then she accesses his server, it forwards the request and so on. And when I gave the same question to a manager, this is his answer. Mallory would give some input for the malicious system to start the attack. Then the system would try to hack or break into the application system, of course disguised. So Alice sees something, but does not realize that it's a malicious attack, or it's a malicious question or a malicious query. She then gives some input to the application system to send out information which would get back to the malicious system. Then I asked, okay, what kind of attack would this be? For instance, a DDoS attack. So if we think back at the question, how can Mallory steal data from the application system, I think a DDoS attack would not be the best for that. And especially the DDoS attack that targets the application system and then still Alice is doing something on the server is kind of strange. So those two are just examples that I got from those seven people. In general, what I've seen is that the management people were less able to really nicely describe an attack. They were mixing the steps in the attacks. They were less fluent with the language. So DDoS attack for stealing data, I'm not exactly sure if he really didn't know the understanding or he was just mixing up some stuff. And the descriptions were less detailed and they were sometimes missing important details of that. So for me, that's a sign that those management people have a less or a more superficial mental knowledge of these attacks, and therefore they probably need different information in a different dashboard. I've also some more data on what questions, what data they need for the dashboard, and that's my next step, how to use this information now to design a nice cybersecurity dashboard. If there are ideas, just contact me. The email is on the slides. Thanks.
Three.
Thanks. Next talk, Cloudfleet, also 3 minutes. Three. Express round.
Okay. So I want to present our project.
Please go behind the mic, yeah.
I want to present our project Cloudfleet. It's a private data center. We want to distribute the data center as well as Apple distributed personal computers. Where? Okay. So the problem is that cloud services are not secure. If you don't pay for the product, you are the product. So companies use your data basically to make profit off it. The solution that you maintain your own server is a pain and takes a lot of time and effort. So we propose a solution to make it easy for people to host their own private data center. It will be, thanks to Moore's law, it can be pretty small, and everyone should have their own private data center at their home. So to make it possible for everybody to have privacy and not only for the people that are technically adept, we want to have a very easy setup process. So basically you pick your domain you want to have access to your private data center under, you get sent the device and you plug it into a router and it's done. You have a global access to it under blimp dot the domain you selected, and you have an replacement for Gmail and Dropbox just at your fingertips. Sorry. So the services that we will provide in our project is we will register the domain, we will have a zero knowledge backup that is encrypted on the device, there will be security updates, there will be a transparent HTTPS proxy that you can access the device from anywhere, and we will also take care of the HTTPS certificate signing, so you have a valid certificate for an end-to-end encryption from the browser to the server. All data on the device will be encrypted. There will be a full disk encryption for the data. Even we will not be able to access the data. That's the most important part. You want to have full control over your data. You don't want to have full control over the algorithms of your data. That's why everything on the device will be open source. And we also will have an API for packaging your own services that use this as a data backend, as a storage backend for your data. We don't want to create just another project, another secure mail client, just another file sync thing. So we will use existing projects. We work together, for example, with the people from MailPile, who created a great client that makes it easy to send PGP encrypted emails. We will use the open sourced Ubuntu file sync server, and we just aim to package the best projects to create a whole new level of a distribution that makes it easy for people to replace cloud services with a private data center. So we just today, just now, we started a crowdfunding campaign for the first people that want to have privacy really at home, at their fingertips. You get 50% off. So and if you back us on the first day, we'll also ship it to you for free. And also this evening we'll have a party at the boat in the harbor that J.R. Tolkien actually. And if you back us today, you will also get a free drink at our party. There is also free food. So this is our homepage, cloudfleet.io. You can go there, back us on Indiegogo. We hope to make it possible to really distribute privacy, to make it possible not for people like us who are able to set up their own mails, their own server, but also for everyone to have an easy workflow to basically erase blanket surveillance by taking the data back to the people, giving the control over data back to the people that own them. Yeah, that's our pitch. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. Sorry for the mix-up. You actually had 5 minutes. I guess people noticed that. So next up is OpenAge and Kevin. I'm still looking for the slides. I seem to have misplaced them here. You sent me an update, right?
Yeah, yesterday.
I got them at some point, but they are not in the in the folder where they are supposed to be. Of course, that does not go out of your time right now. I think I have to check my mail. Yeah, okay. So can you just tell me the URL? Yeah, everybody whistle the Jeopardy melody, please. Almost. So we have to wait for the Wi-Fi.
So
now,
as always, we obviously submitted it 1 minute before the deadline. But
no. Oh, geez. Yeah.
The Wi-Fi is slow.
It's not our fault. No. Actually,
please switch off your Wi-Fi.
It's totally my fault. I'm very sorry for this. Maybe we can just switch.
No.
So, WGET tells me. Yeah. Come on. Let me.
Thank you.
Okay then. What talk is next? Session is over. This will take 5 minutes according to wget. So we should switch talks right now, and you come after the next talk. I'm really sorry, guys, for the mix-up. Oh, geez. Yeah, something has to go wrong. I mean, after. So we can talk about BulkCon now. Ah, there you are. Very nice. So.
Okay, can I start?
Slides, please.
Okay. Hi, all. I'm Jelena, and want to introduce to you and invite you to BulkCon. What is BulkCon? BulkCon is Balkan Computer Conference. It is will be placed in 9, 10, 11 September in Novi Sad in Serbia. You can find here our website. And this year, the new thing will have the badge included in the ticket price. So, what is BulkCon? BulkCon is an international hacking conference organized by Linux User Group of Novi Sad, Lugansk, and Val Holland Foundation. It is the fourth time that we organized BulkCon conference, and until now we are very satisfied. You can find on our website all the media from the last three congresses. The congress it consists from the workshops, lectures, and different presentations. So, if you have some interesting talk, interesting presentation, we are inviting you to send us your submission or our CFP. Our goal is to gather a community on Southeast Europe because the economic situation in that part of Europe not so good as in the rest of part. And young people cannot so much travel to the different conferences, hacker conferences especially. So we want to organize for that people something similar to CCC or other hacker conferences in Serbia, in Novi Sad, so they can come there, join us, play with us, hack together, learn, exchange knowledge, get to know each other. So. Our goal is to become a central hacker community in that part of the Europe. So, important dates, until 1st of July, our CFP will be open. It will be open from end of the January, I think so. And the final notification will be 15th July. And in September, there's a conference. So, sorry. More info about Congress you can find on our website. All information you can, or if you have some questions, you can send us on our email. You can also follow us on Twitter, and you can find us also on IRC channel, channel BulkCon on Freenode. So, if you are interesting, if you have something to talk with us, you have some interesting topic, please send submission or write us email. We are open to. Cooperate with other communities, with other groups of hackers. So please join us, and I hope we'll see you in September in Novi Sad. That's it.
Thank you. So I'm still downloading with 25K per second. It's really slow. Still takes 5 minutes, so we take another talk in front of that. Don't worry, guys, you will still get your time.
Use just less bandwidth.
So, next talk is going to be breaking RSA. Are you there? Yeah, there you are.
My name is Jan Ruger, and I will tell you how to break RSA by using a software-defined radio. So, this is the attack setup that I've used. So, on the left, we've got the device that we're going to be attacked. And the electromagnetic emanations of this device is going to be picked up by the antenna on the top and then digitized by the SDR receiver in the middle. This will then be analyzed by the laptop on the right, and usually the side channel effects are located at frequencies lower than 4 megahertz, so for most SDR receivers you will also need an additional up converter. So. If you start a program on the device under test, you get a spectrogram that looks like the one on the top. So as the program is executed, a new carrier frequencies are appearing. So what you can do is an amplitude modulation to get an indication when the device is performing computations. So this can be used, for example, for alignment. And if you have a closer look on the test program that we've used, you see we've got three lines. The first and the third one are just dummy operations. And in the middle, we've got an OpenSSL exponentiation routine. And if you compare it to the spectrogram, you can see that as the exponentiation routine is executed, we've got very much noise on the frequency axis. So this is also an indication for that, that these carriers are holding frequency modulated side channel information. So you can use GNU Radio to demodulate those signals. And what you get is a spectrogram that looks like this. So and again, here we can clearly distinguish between dummy operations and OpenSSL exponentiations. And so what we now need is a way to get information from those spectrograms. And one way to do so is to use a differential power analysis that was first introduced by Paul Kocher. And the cool thing about this that you also can apply it to spectrograms. So you're choosing two arguments and performing repeatedly measurements with both arguments. And then you can compute the difference of the side channel effects. And this will show you basically a DPA spectrogram that shows you when in time and frequency domain both values are causing different side channel effects. If you compare it, or if you perform a DPA analysis with the OpenSSL exponentiations, and we choose one argument lower than the module and one argument greater than the module, you get a spectrogram that looks like the one on the top. So you can see great differences in the side channel effects. If both arguments are lower than the module, you only get noise. So you, what you can do now is you can distinguish if the input to the exponentiation routine is lower or greater than the module. This is interesting because RSA, by using the Chinese root minor theorem, uses the secret prime as the module for the exponentiation. So, conclusion, we can do basically a binary search by using this side channel effect on the secret prime. And in practice, we roughly needed 120 traces to distinguish both cases. And we're able to extract one bit within 27 seconds. So in practice, this isn't that easy. A great countermeasure is blinding that is enabled by GNUPG and OpenSSL by default. And it will basically randomize the input to the RSA decryption. So this attack isn't possible in practice, but very interesting from a technical point of view. Yeah, GNU Radio is awesome. And on the bottom, you've got the link to the source code. If you've got an SCR with you, you can clone it and play around with this, have fun. And yeah, thanks.
Thanks a lot. So now OpenH and Kevin can, we can start with these two projects. So these are actually two talks, consecutive talks. One is 3 minutes and one is 5 minutes. Which one's going first? OpenH, right? Yep. Okay, then let's go with OpenH.
So, hello. This is Mikir.
And this is JJ.
And as last year already, we are still developing a free open source engine for Age of Empires 2 called OpenH.
And now we have a really cool logo.
Yeah. Where is the presenter? Here. Very good. So the thing is, we still require original assets and try to do a very good gameplay clone with optional goodies. And the main focus is actually on the moddability because you want to extend that that stuff. This brings us to unlimited possibilities. So you can probably implement a zombie survival defend your fortress map someday with more than 8 players, an infinite Minecraft-like map with sane networking that doesn't bug all the time, have over 9,000 units, better team interaction like map painting and stuff, weather, fire. And in the long run, we are planning to have competitive matches with matchmaking and stuff.
Okay, so we have noticed there is a lot of similar projects that are doing the same thing for other games, so maybe there should be some sort of open game clone alliance thingy, just thinking. Next. So our basic technologies are C++ and Python, and humans maybe, who are trying to mix up all that stuff into a game. And we have prepared some screenshots to get you a view of what it looks like right now. Like, this is live game engine output.
And the new things we are currently working on and will be there is OpenGL 3 renderer with Vulkan as well. We are trying to use Qt5 for GUI, implement Nyan as a content description format alternative to YAML, and use some really cool Pathfinder technology that has probably never been used in a RTS so far.
The more bigger to-dos are, of course, AI, networking, multiplayer, Tarot elevations is a thing we haven't done yet, and also the whole tech tree stuff, which is really complicated if you have a look at it. Next.
We're still developing this on GitHub, and it's a spare time project with no deadlines, obviously, so we're trying to do this thing as in the right way. And this also contains an optimal infrastructure goal, which contains lots of style checks, a sane build system, tests, et cetera, which is driven by continuous integration. But we figured that our current system, Travis, is actually pretty sucky, because the build takes, the talks are consecutive. The Travis system is pretty sucky and takes a long time to build our stuff. And this is why we decided to develop a new system called Kevin, which... which pretty much works in the same way as Travis, but is hosted on your own machines.
Next slide. Oh. Previous slide. Okay. So Kevin contains of several components that are interacting with each other. They can be hosted on different machines. The core control component is called Kevin. It receives on pull request, it receives a notification from GitHub, and then it requests a disposable new VM from Falk. Falk launches the VM, and Kevin SSHs into the VM and launches the Chantal component, which is the actual build bot that clones the project, executes the project, and reports results back to Kevin, which then posts them to GitHub, to IRC, wherever you want.
The control file is, as with Travis, within your project and looks like a makefile this time, not YAML. So you have steps that are executed top-down, which may depend on each other. You can configure all kinds of stuff, and all these steps are then reported in live, in real time, back to GitHub. In practice, this looks like the following. So I'm submitting some pull request there, and GitHub shows me that Kevin is now cloning the repo. The steps are received back and are then executed. And we see one of those steps failed, and the others can't be executed now because the dependency is somehow messed up. You can look at the actual output that happened in the VM by curl currently, and see that, yeah, we messed up in the answer part and missed to include OS, so we patched that. And after we fixed it, we run that thing again. VM is booting. Steps are executed. The parts are run. All checks are passed, and we can now merge that request. And all this happens in real time, so you can really see bing, 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 how the things pop up. The VM is deleted, and all user input is discarded.
Right, so that's what we are currently at. Of course, we are planning to add some additional features. It's not really much to do, actually. Like, we want to have a batch, which you can include in readme.md. We want to be able to run the whole thing on the local machine, so you can check whether it will run even before actually submitting the pull request. We want to automatically parse the compiler warnings and make Kevin post comments in the proper code lines of the pull request. If you're familiar with GitHub, it's a really cool feature. You can comment each line of code individually. And of course, there is the web front end Mandy, which doesn't exist yet. So right now, the only way to get feedback from the build is either you can watch the live curl output, or you can just watch the stuff that Kevin posts on GitHub.
So yeah, we can only encourage you to ditch the cloud and maybe try a self-hosted service. I know there exists BuildBot and Jenkins and stuff, but yeah, it's Python 2. We, of course, use Python 3. And BuildBot is now kind of complicated to set up because there are not many templates and stuff. And the GitHub integration is not as cool as ours and live. And of course, this is also a part and a side project of OpenAge, so we can enhance the experience for you, the developers, that hopefully help us create a really cool game that does not exist yet. So if you have any short questions now, I think we have even time for that. Questions? No?
Yeah. So, if there's no questions, there's one thing that we totally forgot to mention earlier. Of course, we want to thank our OpenAge community, the developers community. They have made some awesome contributions. Like, most of the actually visible features are not made by us, but by our internet community. So, thanks you guys. You're really great.
Thanks. Yeah, they are out there watching us now, so hi.
Thanks. So now, last talk for the, before the break, Strichliste, 16 to 9, I think.
Ja, hallo. Ich will euch heute das Tool Strichliste zeigen. Ihr kennt es vielleicht von eurer Bar im Hackerspace mit einem riesen Papierhaufen. Und die Strichliste soll dazu eine Lösung sein. Also ja, es war ziemlich schwer, eine Übersicht zu behalten, wie viel Schulden denn jemand hat oder wie viel Guthaben gerade jemand hat. Und demnach waren auch sehr viele Schuldner immer im System drin. Deswegen haben wir uns überlegt, was brauchen wir denn eigentlich dafür, also was relativ einfach zu benutzen ist. Natürlich Open Source, weil nicht nur wir wollen es benutzen, wir wollen, dass viele Hackerspaces das ganze Ding benutzen. Es soll auf jeder Plattform laufen, soll gut dokumentiert sein und alles soll über die REST API passieren und eben getrennt sein. Und es soll auf jeden Fall kein Warenwirtschaftssystem werden. Es soll hauptsächlich um Buchungen von Beträgen gehen. Der Server, der ist in Node.js geschrieben, ist unit-tested und nutzt aktuell SQLite als Datenbank. Es ist geplant, mehrere zu verwenden oder verschiedene zu verwenden und stellt eine API zur Verfügung, mit der man Transaktionen machen kann, Übersichten anschauen kann, aber auch Statistiken sehen kann, wie viel umgesetzt wurde. Aktuell gibt es einen Webclient dafür, der ist in Angular.js geschrieben und ja, funktioniert in jedem Browser, auch mobil. Deswegen ist das Layout responsive und benutzt nur die REST API des Servers. Aktuell existieren auch verschiedene Sprachen schon dafür, Deutsch, Englisch, Französisch, Portugiesisch und Türkisch. So sieht das Interface aus, das ist typischerweise an einem Tablet gleich an der Bar. Man kann einfach mit einem Tipp auf den User draufklicken und sieht seine Übersichtsseite. Aktuell hat er 3-. Man sieht, durch welche Transaktionen das zustande gekommen sind. Und ja, man kann dann den Betrag, zum Beispiel seine Mate für 1 € da einfach buchen. Die Übersichtsseite geht auch weiter zurück, das heißt, man kann komplett seine Transaktionen anschauen. Ja, es gibt noch jede Menge Features, die dafür geplant sind, unter anderem, dass man direkt Überweisungen machen kann, also von einem Konto zum anderen, Split-Rechnungen in Form von jemand hat gekocht und möchte das aufteilen auf verschiedene Mitesser, Artikel aber nur als Mapping für Preise, dass man sich mit einem Barcode-Scanner eine Mate abpiepsen kann. Ein PIN-Schutz war gefragt für Accounts, wo Leute wollen, das nicht wollen, dass andere Beträge da buchen. E-Mail-Hinterlegung für Abrechnungen, monatlich, wöchentlich, wie auch immer. Und ja, vieles mehr. Wir wollen noch mehr Entwickler, die da mitmachen. Es gibt schon einige Spaces, die das Ganze einsetzen und da auch dazu beitragen. Das Ganze liegt auf GitHub. Ihr könnt über die Webseite strichliste.org euch das alles angucken. Da liegt auch eine Demo. Und ansonsten, ja, ich bin noch an der Backspace Assembly und stellt mir Fragen.
Vielen Dank. Thanks a lot. So we are right on time for the break. Phew. We managed to not do any overtime here. So we'll see you in 15 minutes at 2 o'clock, then the second part continues. Are the integrate people around? Okay, please take a seat. We'll start in 1 minute. All right, let me just say it again. So if you come up to deliver your talk, please remember to talk into the microphone. The people on the streams can't hear you if you turn away from the mic. So trust the monitor on the floor. It really shows the same thing that's up there. And yeah, the mic is your friend. So let's start with the second part of this session. The next talk is going to be Check My HTTPS.
One, two, one, two.
So as I said, talking to the mic, please.
So hello, everybody. My name is Raphael Pion, and he's my friend Hugo Mezzani. So we are two students from France at the EACIA. It's a graduate school of engineering specialized in IT security. So we are working for a project, for the operational cryptology and virology laboratory, which started 6 months ago. The original idea come from Rexy, a researcher belonging to this laboratory. So when you're browsing on HTTPS connections, someone could probably decrypt your connection to steal a bank account or any interesting data. So so the website server certificate seen by the client will change. And this will involve an alert. You could accept this new certificate, but we not recommend you to do this because you will accept a man-in-the-middle attack. But sometimes this alert is not always present. So, for example, a company network firewall can offer options going against the privacy of its employees, especially SSL inspection, which decrypt their HTTPS traffic. The firewall manufacturers justify the addition of these features for security reasons. Indeed, encrypted traffic could be used to bring malwares or viruses into the company network. So an SSL inspection works the same way as an SSL man-in-the-middle attack. The firewall spoofs the identity of the consulted website by forging its own certificate. In addition, the IT team can easily upload the company CA certificate on all the equipment. So when an SSL inspection is enabled, nothing can detect it for a newbie. So you go. Thank you.
Hi, so to reveal that kind of malicious practice, we developed a very, very user-friendly add-on for Firefox called Check My HTTPS. It will compare the server certificate viewed by the client who is using our add-on than the server certificate viewed by the server of Check My HTTPS. It's very simply, it's an OpenSSL command which calculates a fingerprint of the certificate of each side of our system. So if they are the same, you're safe, but if they're not the same, you probably intercepted by an attacker who performed an SSL man-in-the-middle or an SSL proxy installed on your network. We designed this add-on to make it very easy to use. As you can see, you can get it on our website, checkmyhttps.net. You will find all the sources on GitHub. And learn more about SSL inspection, and you will find some very famous software like Avast or Kaspersky, which perform that kind of practice, so SSL decryption. So you can download it on your computer and try it at home during a travel when you are using an untrustly public Wi-Fi network, which can be very dangerous if you are checking your bank account or in your company. It will reveal if someone or something applied any certificate to decipher your SSL traffic just by showing you a very big red lock on the right of your web browser. The main goal of Check My HTTPS add-on is to protect your privacy by showing you the state of your SSL connection. We are developing a second version of our add-on. It will be faster than the first one. And in the future, on Google Chrome, you will can get it. Voilà.
Thank you very much. Next talk, let's get leaving the geeks den and entering the internet governance world.
Hi, everyone. My name is Farzan Abedi, and I'm going to encourage you to enter into internet governance world, hopefully effectively. So I'm going to use some terms. One, geeks stand for the coders and technical community in general that work the internet. And internet governance world stands for policymaking fora or forums that talk about policy, such as Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers or Internet Governance Forum. So why should you come to the internet governance world to interact with two species? One is the politicians and the other is civil society. And why? So politicians take bad decisions due to lack of knowledge, and geeks don't know the avenue in which they can talk to them, or geeks don't want to talk to them. And the result is silly policies that do not make sense and can be harmful. So with civil society, they might be clueless about the technical aspect and they might be shouting about something that they don't know how technically it works. And they also might not know how geeks can easily overcome the problem, and knowing the alternative can actually help them with their cause. But while geeks don't know about them or don't take them seriously, so what? So you first need to care and believe that politicians and civil society actually can and do make decisions that can affect us. And then you need to find the avenues to talk to them and participate in policymaking. And so which avenues? I'm going to make only two examples. These are examples, and there are many more, and that's just because it's in the field of my expertise, I'm saying it. So in Internet Governance Forum, there are politicians and civil society, and you might say, oh, they're too junior, or oh, this is like non-binding policy, just merely talk shows. However, there are many decisions that at the core are made by junior people. And so, you know, you listen to this boring talk from the UN, Ban Ki-moon is saying something. You really think Ban Ki sat down and wrote that speech? Well, no, it was by some junior staff. And they put ideas in the brain of the decision makers. And then ICANN, this is where real policy making takes place. And civil society gets involved with the process and makes policies. And you might say, oh, I don't care about domain name system. But you might care about freedom of expression or security and other things. And you can help civil society by getting involved with these policy makings and hold ICANN accountable. So be a part of policy making. So this was just to nag and drag you guys out of your den and ask you to join us because, well, we need you, because it's fun to correct people when they talk out of their, and then because you can be effective in making policies that are sane.
Thanks a lot. Next talk is going to be Omimo, or Omemo.
Omimo,
you probably
right.
Pronounce it correctly
it's
now.
Omimo. Okay. Hi, So my name is Andy, and I built Omemo, which is a end-to-end encryption protocol for XMPP, and I will present it to you today. But first, let's talk about some history. So I've been using XMPP for a long time now, and I was always a big proponent of using OTR to protect your messages. But but I wasn't really happy with it because there wasn't a good Android client for XMPP, so I was stuck using like WhatsApp or Hangouts or whatever. But then my friend Daniel came along and he said, well, if nobody else is going to do it, then I will. And he built Conversations, which is a great open source XMPP client. You can get it right now. It's awesome. But then, so everything was happy, kind of, but not really, because then a new problem came up, which is that OTR kind of isn't built for a multi-client world. And let's look at that in more detail. So let's say you have two people that want to communicate. One of them is using Conversations. One of them is on Pigeon right now. But they both have several clients, so they can just talk and like it's encrypted, everything's fine, but now what happens if this one person goes offline and maybe moves to a different client? Well, it kind of depends, but in the end the connection will break down because OTR just doesn't work that way. The left guy is super confused because he doesn't know if you want to send another message now, what other client is he directed to, or maybe he will come back online. He just doesn't know, so he basically can't send another message until the other guy comes back online. And the other guy's super pissed off because his message history is like not synchronized, and everything's kind of annoying right now. So let me take a moment here to say that I'm not saying OTR sucks. I'm saying OTR is actually really good at what it does, but it just so happens that what it does is not really what people want anymore, so something had to be done. So I enrolled in the Google Summer of Code and basically built a new protocol, designed it, and implemented it. And let's look at some of the requirements we came up with. So the big ones are history synchronization and the ability to reach offline contacts. So you can just send messages and it'll just work. And now you might say, well, that already works if you're using PGP, but we also want forward secrecy, which is especially important in instant messaging, in my opinion. And also, it has to be easy to use, which PGP definitely isn't, unfortunately. So we built this new thing. And it should just work. You should just be able to turn it on and basically forget it's even turned on. It should just work as like before. So a little caveat, crypto is hard. So I intentionally didn't want to design from scratch my own like crypto system. So luckily, the guys at Open Whisper Systems built Axolotl for TextSecure, their encryption for TextSecure. And it's actually great for us, so I just reused that because it was originally built for SMS, so it's asynchronous by nature. So it works with offline contacts, and it basically solves a lot of problems for us. So I'm using this protocol as a key delivery mechanism, which we will look at right now. So let's say there's two people now, they're both on Conversations, which has had this support for a couple months now, and a new Gadget plugin just came out, so they both have it installed on their Gadget plugin, but they don't know those clients yet, so they don't know the fingerprints. And now the left guy wants to send a message. Now, he first has to fetch a prekey, just like in regular TextSecure, from the other, from his contact server, which will basically tell him about his the key of this new thing, and then he can say, I want to trust it or I don't. And then he can just send one message, and this message, each message is encrypted with a new, fresh, random key, and then we basically use long-standing sessions with those contacts, which you can see there, with colored by those different locks, to basically encrypt the payload key. So it's kind of like PGP in that sense. And now if the other guy wants to respond, even though this other Gadget guy is offline right now, that doesn't matter. He can just fetch the prekey and use that to build the session, even though he has never seen this thing before, like trust the key or not, and then send a message. And it's, again, one message that is sent out, and it's mirrored by the server using Carbon's and Message Archive Management, XMPP extensions, to all the relevant parties in that communication. So it just works. You just turn it on once. You have to trust the key once, and then you can just use it. So I encourage you to try it. You can read more if you want more, know more technical details. Find me after the talk, or check out the top link there, that's the specification we wrote for it, which is currently in the process of being adopted. Buy it on the Play Store. Please support Daniel. He's done awesome work. And it's all open source, so you can check the implementations as well. And if you want to know more, find me after the talk. My extension is 2644. Thanks.
Thanks a lot. Next talk is going to be Elisa Org. So where are you? There you are.
All speakers, all coming up speakers, please keep in mind, go to the front if your talk is next, if you see that your talk is next, so we can keep things flowing.
Okay, can I start?
Yeah, start.
Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm Philip. I'm with Eliza.org, and I just want to tell you a little bit about what we do, what we've been doing, and what it is we're trying to achieve, and that we need as many of you as we can get to join us. So our mission is to let people solve global issues by finding solutions for them together on one platform, which sounds very much like something like Stack Overflow, but this is meant for big issues in the real world related to refugee crisis, world hunger, and those kinds of things. And for that, we built a website, which is currently in very early beta phase, but you can already check it out at eliza.org. So what does that look like in practice, or what can you do on Eliza? You can search for issues. So if you're in Germany right now, you might want to get involved in solving the refugee crisis somehow, or at least helping with it. You could do that on eliza.org. If you are an NGO, if you're an active helper or something like that, you can use the site to share your knowledge and share best practices about what you've tried, what worked, and what hasn't worked. And if you're just a passive observer, you can go on the site and kind of comment on ideas, upvote or downvote them maybe, and kind of, you know, get involved in the discussion and contribute in other ways. So our first use case at the moment, is actually the refugee crisis, and that's the only real content we currently have on the site, but we're looking to expand to all kinds of different things in the future. So that might look like this. So someone wants to help refugees find the job, and they go on eliza.org, and there someone else has already, you know, written an article about how they did it in their city, and then this other person can go ahead and edit that article, maybe even add a translation to German, English, or Arabic, or some other language, so it can help more people. Or maybe you're a refugee yourself and you want to figure out, okay, how can I easily learn German now that I'm here? And someone, and this is actually also a real article we have on the site, wrote about their experience when they came to Germany, what the easiest way for them to kind of do that was. So that's how that can look in practice, and those are things that you could do on the site right now. Like I said, it's still pretty early on in development, so don't expect everything to work super smoothly, but the basic gist of it is already working. So yeah, our vision is to then, after we kind of nail the first bit of it, go on to include content from other issues. So this example was someone in Mexico seeing that unemployment is a big problem, and someone in Zimbabwe saying, well, it's also a problem here, and here's a program we've tried to implement, and this has helped some people. So what does our organization look like? We have a e.V. in Germany, founded recently. The whole thing came out of a one-week hackathon, kind of, with Lynn Kaiser, who is, he runs his own NGO, and he kind of figured that there's a lot of problems in this area, and so he wanted to help. And the way we're organized is basically four different teams, but if you want to get involved, you can do basically anything that you feel like you could contribute with. I'm personally in the development team. We also have content team, which currently has the job of writing articles, but ideally down the road, they should just kind of advertise other people to write articles. We have a community outreach team, which kind of tries to get in contact with NGOs and things like that. We have basic just marketing kind of, which, I mean, all these things overlap a lot, but the point is, no matter what you do, there's probably a way for you to get involved in this if you find it interesting. So yeah, and our outlook as an organization is kind of to build a base of content, so the site is already useful for people right now, and then gain some momentum, maybe partner up with something like the UN, because they actually have the problem of not being able to share the best practices that their involved organizations develop over the years. They have some programs for this, or some software for this on their site, but it's really not used and not very usable. And down the road, we really hope that this can make a difference in many issues. So yeah, that's basically it. If you want to get involved, find me after the talk. I'm sitting right over there. Unfortunately, I don't have an extension. You can just visit eliza.org, or you can email me at that address if you can remember it that quickly. My name's Philip with one L and two P's, and my last name is like bowling with a D. So yeah, thanks a lot, and I hope some of you will join us.
Thank you. So, an information for the video team, the next two talks are going to be widescreen as well. So don't switch back. So, next talk, Hyderabadi.
Hi, can I start? Okay. Hello, my name is Tomir Bachar, I'm a reverse engineer, and I created Hyderabadi, who, if you're a reverse engineer, is going to be your new best friend. So, when I was a kid, I used to use Microsoft Office a lot, write cool presentations and stuff. And I had a really good friend, Clippy, the annoying little thing that kept popping up and saying, well, do you want to create a document? Do you want to do something? It was pretty useless, but a lot of fun. Then in 2007, Microsoft killed it. And my friend was lost. I didn't know what to do. I felt really lonely. I was sure that it was going to be forever alone. But after some time and effort, I found out about the Emacs Doctor, and well, now I have someone to talk to on the computer. It's great, but it's not annoying enough. I mean, I always know what it's going to say. It's not bugging me at all. It's only when I want to talk to it, it never pops up and bugs me. So I went to some human friends, but again, they were too helpful to be considered as good as Clippy, because you go to them, you ask them something, and they actually try and help you. So it was not a good solution as well. So after some time, and you know, we started reverse engineering and scripting and stuff like that. So I said, well, most of my time I use IDA, so why not have a new friend there? So I created IDABuddy. IDABuddy is basically a new drop-in replacement for Clippy. It pops up whenever you don't want it to show up and says something completely useless, either like directing you to a point. It can direct you to a new, completely useless address. It can tell you to give up and basically do anything that doesn't help you. More than that, it's completely open source, so no one is going to take it away from you. You're going to have it forever. And it's configurable, so if it's not annoying enough, you can always make it more annoying or show different annoying images. So basically, it's your new best friend. It's friendly. It's, well, that's a line in the slides. It's not helpful at all. And it's a lot of fun when it pops up and says, well, maybe you want to try this address or just, you know, give up because you're not doing any good. And that's about it. You can find it on my GitHub. And have fun with it. And obviously, it has a pretty limited vocabulary and dictionary so far, so it says only a little bit of annoying stuff. You're welcome to donate to it and, you know, make it be more and more annoying. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. The next talk is going to be Art on your screen. This time for real.
Okay. So, also zur Abwechslung mal ein Talk auf Deutsch. Art on the Screen. Ich war gestern schon hier und habe über den App Art Award gesprochen. Nur zur Erinnerung, da ging es um ein neues Kunstformat, wie man Kunst in einer App sehen kann. Art on the Screen ist eine, kann man sagen, damit befreundet so ein bisschen. Da geht es darum, Kunst im Browser. Ihr kennt ja sicher Kunst in verschiedenen Formen. Ihr kennt Kunst als Gemälde, Kunst als Musik, Skulptur, Performance, alles Mögliche. Aber es gibt natürlich auch Kunst im Netz. So, jetzt ist natürlich die Frage, wie präsentiert man Kunst im Netz und was für Möglichkeiten gibt es da, Kunst zu zeigen und zu fördern. Ich bin unter anderem vom ZKM Karlsruhe, das ist ein großes Museum, was sich in Karlsruhe rund um das Thema Kunst und Medientechnologie kümmert und damit befasst. Und wir haben ein Format entworfen, das nennt sich Art on the Screen oder auch etwas unaussprechbar AOIS, wenn man es abkürzt. Jetzt sagt jeder nur Eis, Eis. Also ich weiß auch nicht, verwirrt mich immer. Jedenfalls geht es dabei Kunst in der vernetzten Welt. Wie kann man das vernetzte Internet, die ganzen Kommunikationsmöglichkeiten nutzen und in Kunst umsetzen oder damit Kunst fördern? Da gibt es verschiedene Ansätze. Im Prinzip sehen wir immer, der Browser ist das Canvas. Der Browser ist deine Fläche und alles passiert im Browser. Der Browser ist immer dabei, der Browser ist immer verfügbar, auch nachts um drei, auch im Hotel in Jamaika. Es ist nicht ortsgebunden, nicht zeitgebunden. Kunst kann zu jedem Zeitpunkt betrachtet und angeschaut werden. Jedenfalls bieten wir da eine Plattform und wir stellen auch immer ein paar nette Kunstwerke aus. Also ihr könnt auch da mit teilhaben, wenn ihr eine Idee habt, könnt ihr die auch einreichen und wir machen da immer so Ausstellungen. Wie sieht das eigentlich aus? Das ist jetzt zum Beispiel die aktuelle Seite. Das ist von einem Künstler. Die verschiedenen Werke werden so ein bisschen wie das Internet vernetzt angezeigt mit Linien. Man kann sich da so durchschieben, die einzelnen Werke angucken und auch ein bisschen umschalten. Und je nachdem, also es kommt immer darauf an, was die Künstler machen. Da gibt es verschiedene Möglichkeiten. Eine davon ist unter anderem die Verbindung der On- und Offline-Welt. Also ihr kennt das ja, ihr kauft bei Amazon rein digital ein und es kommt aber zum Beispiel dann rein physikalisch bei euch zu Hause an. Das ist ein Effekt, den kann man künstlerisch ausschöpfen. Wir hatten ein Werk, das war eine Lampe, das war sehr lustig, die konnte man nur im Internet anschalten und nur vor Ort ausschalten. Ja, das stand in dem öffentlichen Raum und dann immer, wenn irgendwelche Abendveranstaltungen waren, dann ging auf einmal diese Lampe an. Und es war auch eine kleine Webcam. Also man konnte hingehen, im Internet gucken, wenn sie jemand ausmacht, dann wieder auf anklicken. Und es hat immer so ein tolles Geräusch mit so einem Klacken gemacht. Jedenfalls, also das ist zum Beispiel eine der Möglichkeiten, wie man da Kunst machen kann. Das ist dann ein Werk, was man zwingend in beiden Dimensionen, sowohl in der realen als auch in der virtuellen Dimension erleben muss, damit es vollständig ist. Genau, also das ist so ein bisschen das Prinzip davon. Ihr könnt ja vielleicht auch was Neues erfinden. Das ist noch ein bisschen frisch, wenn ihr eine Idee habt. Ich glaube, vieles von dem, was manche Leute im Netz programmieren, kann man schon als Kunst sehen. Sie wissen es bloß nicht. Also denkt mal drüber nach, was ihr so Schönes macht. Es ist auf jeden Fall immer cool. Genau. Das ist Art on your Screen. Ihr könnt auch teilhaben. Kontaktinformationen bekommt ihr entweder über das Web oder auch direkt von mir, da ist ein Tippfehler in der Telefonnummer. Meine Telefonnummer ist 6259 oder auch OBLX. Genau, viel Spaß beim Entdecken oder auch Mitmachen.
Vielen Dank. So, again, an information for the video team. We are now switching back to old school 4-3 ratio. I think, yes, we do. Pin magic.
Oh, hi, 32C3. Usually I start these talks with, my name is Grintold, I'm from OpenLib Augsburg, and I do free software stuff. Today it's a bit different, but more for that later. I will introduce you to pin magic. Pin magic is the maker's scratch board, as you can see. And I have a little story. I once went to school. I'm sure some of you did too, and at some point in their educational career, they did a topic of learning about digital circuitry, digital logics. And in my school, we had a logic simulator that had like a static one line and a static zero line, and then you could click some gates together, and then there was some output. But most of the friends that I did this with found this really boring. I found this kind of fascinating, but today we live in a world where we have a Raspberry, we have Arduino, and we can actually let those logic simulators talk to the real world. So, my project is Pin Magic, and what it does is pretty simple. You have an UI, you click together some logic gates, you assemble a circuit, then Pin Magic will compile everything down to Python. And then you can do a Python file on your Raspberry Pi. And the Raspberry Pi will execute the designed circuit with its GPIO pins. And you can talk to it through the GPIO pins of your Raspberry Pi to the outside world. Usually, people who know me know that I like to do live demos. But in this format, unfortunately, this isn't possible. So I brought a screenshot. I've built a prototype, and this is it. On the left screen side, you see an input node. You see the pin headers of the GPIO pins. In the middle, you see some logic gates, AND gates to be precise. And on the left side, you see the outputs. So you can model a circuit from input to output, and the Raspberry will then actually do it. I've built this prototype,
And in the course of the next 9 months, I want to build a full version of this. Currently, there are only AND gates and one more magic demo gate that I will present at our assembly that no one has seen before. You will be the first to see it. To make this real, I started a Kickstarter campaign. Yeah, this was one too much. I started a Kickstarter campaign, and there you will find a detailed description of what will be happening and what the tool will be able to do. I hope for your all support. And please spread the word. If you know Raspi enthusiasts or you are Raspi enthusiasts yourself, please stop by at our assembly, or if I'm not there, call me at DECT8081 and I will show you the prototype. You can you will be able to see if the campaign succeeds, the prototype and the development of the project in an open fashion on GitHub at the address here. You can email me at grimtold@scarf.org, or you can write me in Jabber if you want to. Thanks for your...
Thanks a lot. Have a nice Congress. So next talk is going to be circles.
And all speakers have fade in the monitor. It's right in front of you. You don't need to look up here. It's all in front of you.
Right. I try.
So let me just put on your slides. There it is.
Right. So the next talk will be about circles, and more specifically about the universal basic income. I hope a lot of you have heard of this concept and are already familiar with it. I will not explain it. I will just already assume that we all want it. And circles is about implementing it right into our money system. So we have the option to take our current money system, let's say the euro, build something on top, for example, call it government, they collect tax and they pay out the basic income. But there might be a more efficient way, a way to do it now, a way to do it without borders, and maybe even without governments. So a way to builds the basic income directly into our monetary system, directly into our money. A short quote from Bernard Lyotard basically says, money is an agreement and we have choices. And we have the choice to build the basic income into our money system. I argue that the decentralized economy needs a decentralized money. We have a good start. We have currencies like Bitcoin or Ether, but from a global perspective, they are not decentralized. They are mainly speculative, but the technology is very, it's awesome, the blockchain, and it would allow a currency like circles. The core idea is money is distributed per person. Everyone gets its basic income, and it's constantly just new money is constantly created. The big technical problem is how to solve the Sybil attack problem in a decentralized way. So we don't want one single entity that says you're a valid person or that's an ID or whatever, but we want to solve it in a decentralized way. And the solution, I can only give a short idea of it. The idea would be that in the first place, everyone starts with its own personal currency, and you can create as much as you want, but it only gains in value as soon as you connect to other people. And connecting to other people would mean you set your currency and the currency of others at a one-to-one exchange rate, and you build your circles. You build circles of people that share and accept each other currencies and therefore provide each other basic income. This approach combines the resilience of local currencies. There have been interesting concepts of local currencies, but it combines it with the efficiency of a global currency. And that's possible with the blockchain. So in short, who is for those who are more involved in cryptocurrencies, it's basically Ripple plus universal basic income is Circle. It's a money creation process that serves people, everyone, not banks. So credit is approved based on the idea of a basic income and not on a credit rating system. That does not need to be paid back. We would implement the basic income directly into the money system. The current implementation is on Ethereum. Ethereum allows exactly this. It allows to build huge social contracts, and that's essentially what money is in a decentralized way. I would be very happy to talk more about the real technical stuff and the code, and we will have two sessions tonight at 5 and at 7 at the Bitcoin Assembly. It's in the room next to the Garderobe at the Eingangsbereich. Would happy to see you there. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. So we are staying in the cryptocurrency field right now with the next talk called Altea.
Hello, I'm Johan Trembeck. I'm going to tell you about Altea, which is an incentivized mesh routing system I'm working on. So what is incentivized mesh? Incentivized mesh is an idea that I've had and other people have had for creating internet access. And instead of ISPs collecting subscription fees and making peering deals, the network hardware is paid for by the network itself. So if you're familiar with mesh networking like Frifunk, or there's also ones in the US as well, these use self-configuring routing protocols, which lets anybody set up a router on their roof or whatever, and the protocol figures out how to route packets. So I'm trying to create a payment layer as well, so the protocol also figures out how much each router should be paid. So the idea is that people can set up hardware, people can set up uplinks to the greater internet, and the packets get routed over cheap, reliable routes, and people get paid without there being a business collecting the fees and owning the hardware. So this is using two technologies. First, payment channels. Like the Lightning Network and Bitcoin, if you've heard of it, but it's a way of sending payments with a very low overhead. And then also Babel, which is one of the better mesh routing protocols. And I figured out some modifications to that to allow it to route according to link cost as well as quality. I'll just go through this quickly, basically to have a more efficient marketplace so that you don't have a local monopoly of a last mile ISP to hopefully bring down prices. So basically nodes pay each other to forward packets. You don't pay for download access, you just pay for upload. So if you're trying to get packets from somewhere, then you have to pay the source of the packets they push through the network. And link pricing data is propagated by Babel in the same way that it propagates link quality data. So I'll show you how that works. So here's how Babel works right now. And the links are rated with a metric. You see these numbers on the links. And higher is worse. And so they exchange information about all of their links with the other nodes. And then the information is added together to figure out which the best paths are. So for instance, for I to get to D, you can see going through B it would cost 9, but going through C it would cost 7. And so I then chooses to go through C and then propagates that information on further to other nodes that are connected to it. So I'm adding distance vector plus cost. And so each node has a cost as well they're choosing to charge. And this is also added in the other column here. And so as you can see, going through B, B is slightly worse quality, but it costs less. So as you can see, I has now chosen to go through B instead. It's made the trade-off based on balancing quality plus cost. So that's the basic principle of the system. I'm just starting to implement it now, but there are Babel is easy to extend. There are already other extensions to Babel that incorporate, for example, latency, not just like Babel basically uses reliability, but there's also extensions to do latency. So I think using a similar mechanism, I can also put monetary costs into it. And I actually have another lightning talk right after this, and I'll show you how the payment system will work to allow the low overhead payments. And then also there's the glue software just to have nodes charge each other and take care of all the stuff, hooking everything together. So I guess I have a little more time. Other projects I researched, a lot of these I couldn't reach the creators. They seem a little bit, they don't seem to be really being maintained, but there's Open Libernet. And it is based on NetSukuku, which is a routing protocol. I tried to email them, haven't heard back, so I mean, if they're watching it, it'd be great if you can get in touch. And also Hawknet seems similar. They have a subreddit. And both of these projects are kind of based on this global mesh. They have routing protocols that should work on a global scale, but mine uses Babel, so it's just for last mile providers. So with autonomous systems, you need a subnet for your local city or whatever. So that's it.
Okay, thank you. Now, the next talk.
Okay, so universal payment channels. This is the payment system that I've come up with to allow this incentivized mesh system to work. So you need something where people can pay each other with very low overhead, because nodes will be paying each other, many times, not per packet necessarily, but close to that. So this is inspired actually by the Lightning Network in Bitcoin. However, it is simpler and more flexible. It won't work on Bitcoin, but it will work on Turing-complete cryptocurrencies such as Ethereum. So it could possibly be made to work, for example, with Circles. Not sure. And it will also work with real money, provided that banks are running a certain software on their systems. Real money, I mean national currencies, of course. Ethereum, Bitcoin, also real money. So it uses escrow provided by the bank or the blockchain. Nodes can pay each other by exchanging signed notes or messages. And per payment, the bank or blockchain is not involved, and that's what makes it scalable. Payments can also be locked up with smart conditions, so a certain condition needs to be met. Some code is evaluated by the bank or blockchain, and it is not released, the payments are not released if it doesn't return true. And then the smart conditions also allow the channels to be combined into multi-hop payments, so that nodes don't have to have channels directly open. But I'll show you how it works. So Alice and Bob want to open a channel, so they deposit money with a bank, $100 a piece. And they sign a contract with a bank that says, return this money to us when you received a message signed by both of us, change the amounts that you return to us. So then Alice sends a message to Bob, and she adjusts her balance to 95 and Bob's to 105, and she signs it. And so this is basically like Alice is giving Bob $5. So Bob gives that to the bank. The bank gives... in this last step, you see the bank or blockchain is not involved whatsoever. Alice could send an infinite number of these, doesn't matter, and it could be a very small amount of data, really. So Bob gives this to the bank, and he signs it and gives it to the bank, and the bank pays the money back out. So of course, Bob could cheat. He could keep an old one and give that to the bank and get some money he's not supposed to have. So, we put a sequence number and a hold period. And so this says now the bank needs to wait for the hold period before returning the money, and if somebody during that time gives them a sequence, another note with a higher sequence number, they honor that note instead. So as long as Alice checks with the bank, and Alice and Bob check with the bank every hold period, or 2 days in this example, they can stop each other from cheating and still instantaneously exchange payments. So if they don't want to wait, if they both agree that they want to close the channel and get their money out, they can set the hold period to none, and then it will pay out immediately. So it's adjustable. Then I'll see if I have enough time to go through this. There's also the smart conditions. So they would say basically that you have to evaluate this code and only pay out if it returns true. So this is a hash lock smart condition. This is also something that comes from the Lightning Network. Basically, if it says you have to get a string that hashes to this specific hash before paying the money out. And so if Alice wants to pay Charlie, but she doesn't have a channel open with him, she goes through Bob. And she makes a hash-locked payment to Bob, and she gives Charlie the secret. And then Bob makes a hash-locked payment to Charlie, and it locked with the same hash. And so Charlie can reveal that to Bob and the bank, or just Bob, and get the money, have the channel adjusted to, you know, the new balances. And then Bob uses that secret to get his money from Alice. And so nobody really has to trust each other here. The only party that's being trusted is the bank or the blockchain. So people have to have faith that the blockchain or the bank are reliable. This is showing the unlocking process here. You see the secret goes, the money comes. Also, the channels, they just need to be hash locked with the same hash. They don't need to be with the same bank or the same blockchain or the same currency even. So you can see Alice wants to get to Doris here. She goes through Bart and Conrad, who have a Dogecoin channel open. This works fine. So right now I've just got some very beginning implementations of it, but I have a paper and an easy article, blog article. You can check out the websites. It's altheamesh.com. And if you want to contact me, I forgot to put that on, but it's at the bottom of that website. So.
Thanks. Right on time. So there's going to be a small deviation from the schedule. The next talk is canceled, and instead we are going to have two, I'd call them last minute talks right now. One is called Integrate, which is coming up next, and after that we'll have something I guess you can call Internet of Pokemon, but first of all we'll continue with Integrate.
Okay, hello everybody, this is Bengin, my name is Sven, thank you for enabling this talk. Basically this talk is going to be a call for developers and an invitation for city administrations and governments to use the software we are building. First let us show you the software or the project. Our goal is to establish a system where cities, governments and large organizations can provide information for refugees in Germany, or not especially in Germany, every country or every city can use it. We will provide this system for free. Everybody can, you do not have to pay for it using it. And city governments and organizations can put their information into a content management system which is built on WordPress and translate the information into several languages. And this information is then available in an app which is caching the information offline, so you don't need to have internet connection to get information. As I said before, this system is free. You just have to contact us and talk to us about using it. The primary goal is for the whole system or the program to be multi-language. And easy to use. So it should be easy for city governments to input their information. We cannot do a live presentation, but we got some screenshots of the app. If you start the app, you get the screen where you can choose your location. Currently, we got several cities in the app already. If you select a city, for example, Augsburg, then you get a selection of languages. Currently, for Augsburg, there's, for example, Arabic, Farsi, English, German, and French available, and then you get the content. So the content management is not a wiki system, so not everybody can contribute content. It's more an editorial system where city government, for example, has to confirm the content, but we need developers for, how it looks when you got the selected German content. And you can select for every article you are in, you can directly select another language. So if you're, for example, speaking Arabic and someone next to you speaking Farsi, you can read the article in your language and select the other language and give the smartphone to your neighbor. Okay, currently we are working on porting the whole project to Xamarin, and therefore we need developers. We also need new templates and designs for WordPress. We also have a large list of issues we have to solve and new ideas we want to implement in the back end and the front end. So yeah, if you have spare time, you're welcome to help us developing this project. I think it's pretty good. It's open source as well, so you can use it on your own, but we are providing free hosting for cities, so if you like, you can just use it and contact us. And again, please help us. We need developers.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. All right, I forgot the contact address. You can contact us at integrateapp.de, the website, and email address info@integrateapp-app.de. Thank you.
Thanks. So now the last talk for today, TC Poke. Your slides should come up in a minute.
Yeah. Hey.
There they are.
So I decided yesterday evening that I wanted to talk about this thing I made. It's basically a product that mixes together all these ingredients, and I hope you know some of them, and you can find about the others that you don't know. So basically, it's like connecting Game Boy to the internet. So the Game Boy uses this Game Link cable that it's a lot like SPI. It has a clock, and but the difference is that it can be driven by both ends. And who drives the clock is kind of up to the game, so it's kind of flexible, but also kind of tricky to work with. So I decided to hook this up to a Teensy, and the hardware is really like simple. You just connect the resistors, or like to avoid shorting everything when two things talk to each other at the same time. Looks like this when I build it. It's not like a new thing, and the hardware is pretty simple. But the software for actually like talking across the internet and being able to play games across the internet is kind of impossible because internet is not synchronous, and SPI is kind of like the master clocks these bytes, and then it wants a response instantaneously, and there's too much latency to make it work. So it's not really possible in general. But the first thing that you can do is like just communicate with Arduino directly. So there's a disassembly of Pokemon game, and I took some code and re-implemented some other parts as an Arduino sketch. And you can use this to trade with your Arduino, with your Game Boy, and like, evolve your Graveler into a Golem and like hack some crazy glitch Pokemon into your Game Boy and do whatever you want. But I kept thinking about this internet-connected part, and actually I found a trick for Pokemon specifically, because as a slave, the Game Boy waits for data. So if you can trick both Game Boys at both ends to being slaves, the Teensy can set the rate at which data is transferred, and latency is not really a problem. So I made a program that specifically does this for Pokemon Red and Blue and Yellow. So it emulates the handshake with the Teensy as the master, and then it waits for bytes from the slaves to start sending, and then it sort of goes back and forth translating the slave data. And I made a Chrome app that interfaces over WebRTC and USB across the internet, so you can actually trade Pokemon across the internet. And the speed is not great, but it works. And you can go to this address and find all the code and all the schematics and all the videos and install it and build it and contact me and like, or even like adjust this for other games that you want to play across the internet on your Game Boy, and I hope you like join the fun. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So, just a short announcement. As I said, we... What? Okay. So we don't have a schedule for tomorrow in the wiki, not in the Mirror wiki and not in the current wiki, if it's on or not. So I'm going to publish the schedule for tomorrow sometime this afternoon somewhere. And if you want to know where that is, you should look at the C3 Lightning Talk Twitter account. I'll just show it. I try to show it on the big screen here. Can you turn back on my... Yeah, that's it. So there you can see that that's the account, and the news where I publish the schedule for tomorrow should be there this afternoon. So this session is over right now. We finished on time, even though we had some problems in the middle and had some last minute talks. Thank you for your attendance, and I hope to see you all tomorrow. Also, furthermore, again, a big round of applause for the translation team. I'm sorry about the last minute talks. You didn't get the slides for that. So please give them a warm round of applause again.